child entertainer for your family and friends?
When I was a child, my mother, my stepmother really encouraged us in terms of the arts and a love of writing and poetry and music. Because, well, when I came along, there was no television. And most everybody had a piano, so we took piano lessons. I came in came up during the alphabet days, you know, the WPA, all those where the artists were part of that system. That's how they worked. You could, so most people were taking, a lot of people were taking piano lessons and dancing lessons and that kind of thing who might not have otherwise. And because there was an absence of television, most of the amusements we had came from, well, not even that time radio, because my mother didn't, we didn't have a radio for a long time. But you had to, when friends came to see us, came to see my mother, you had to, we children were required to do something, show our report cards, dance. My brother and I, we would play the piano. So my sisters and I, we would do a duet on the piano, that kind of thing.
When did you know you wanted to be an actress, and where did you go for training?
Well, before I wanted to be an actor, I wanted to be a writer, because my mother had introduced us to the poets, like Lawrence Chalk, Paul Lawrence Dunbar, and County Cullen, and Jesse Fawcett, were poets and writers like that. So I began to write, and she promptly sent it to the local paper, and they printed it. So, you know, and she sent another one from my sister, and that was printed, and another one. So I had about four poems in print by the time I was 9 years old. So something went off in me, and I began to write. And with all of this performing for the guests and the company, I was beginning to sense that I liked this. And indeed, I was lucky, because so many children are not sort of discovered by their parents, which is one of the most important places to be discovered.
So where did you get your training as an actress?
Mostly at the American Negro Theater in Harlem, in the County Cullen Library. That's where I got most of the beginning of my training in the theater. We were allowed company on Sundays, and there was this boy who used to come to see me, who belonged to another church. And also I could draw, so I was helping draw the church programs. And he told me about the theater on just a couple of blocks from where I lived, and across town on 135th Street. And that's where I got into the American Negro Theater, one of the most fortunate occurrences in my life. Every child, I think, should have such a connection, and I'm sure a lot of them do. And that's where I got into the American Negro Theater.
You got your first film job with a government film.
Is my first film job was when it was a government film. It was a film for the government, made for the army, and it was where I played the part of a nice girl who had it. They were doing films about venereal disease. I didn't know it at the time. But anyway, they had come to the American Negro Theater to looking for actors. I came in very late. I don't know how I happened to, whether I was, it was planned for me to audition or meet the people, I don't know how, but at any rate, they were waiting for me when I got there. And we talked, and I got the part, you know, and when I saw the movie, I mean, I hadn't realized fully what it was all about until after I saw the movie. I read the script, but I wasn't reading it with eyes wide open, you know what I mean? And I looked like such a nice girl.
I'm sure you did. How did you get your first Hollywood film, No Way Out?
No Way Out. Well, that was I had married by then, and I'd been up for the film. We'd heard about this film for a very long time. It was my first real Hollywood film where we had an agent and so forth. But then I was going to have a baby. So there was some rule in the book, in the union manual that mitigated against my getting the part because I was pregnant. And I just went home and I boo-hooed my, here I am. And as much as I wanted a baby, I forgot about how much I wanted a baby. I was overwhelmed by the fact how much I really did want to work in this film with my husband and Sidney Poitier. But would you believe that shortly after my great boo-hoo, I lost that baby, which got me to thinking about a lot of things, At any rate, the agent called up the casting people right away and told them that I had lost the baby and I was in good health and so forth. So instead of playing Sydney's wife, I played my husband's wife in No Way Out. And that's how that all came about.
And that was directed by Joseph Mankiewicz?
And it was directed by Joseph Mankiewicz and people like Fred O'Neill, who was with the American Negro Theater. A lot of people that I knew were in it. And it was our first trip to Hollywood. It was an exciting time for us. When I got to Hollywood, I wasn't prepared for anything. I was just overwhelmed by the place. It was so beautiful. The people were all beautiful, and they were all white, and it was like a paradise kind of place. The houses looked as if, I remember feeling, you could take a spatula and scrape them off the horizon, the houses had no basements, somebody told me. So immediately that came to mind. The whole thing, it would come up with a spatula, and used to have the same scene on the spatula. Anyway, that wasn't true. There's some profoundly beautiful people there, and I learned a lot about the business. But I did feel strange when we had to go into a little room where they took pictures of you, and they talked about, our eyebrows are a little thick there, and what you had to do to come up to par in this atmosphere, and that there was a thought that perfect beauty was at stake. It counted a great deal. And I remember in those days we supplied our own costumes. We brought out, and if they were ordinary modern day clothes, you were expected to bring them. And I remember bringing my clothes. And at one juncture, I was on the stage, and I think I was on the set, and a wardrobe woman came through, and she had some sling pumps on her fingers. And there was another wardrobe woman who I could see. And as she passed by, she held the shoes up like this, and she went. I thought that was so, and I remember that gesture, you understand? I said, oh my God. Eyebrows and noses and lips and shoes and things. So I began to feel, like I really was this little black girl from Harlem, with raggedy shoes and terrible hair. But I didn't feel bad in a sense. There was something that even that attitude didn't disturb in me at that time. Of course, things got a little different. And there were some beautiful people there. And we did manage to have some black hairdressers introduced to join the union, the hairdressers union.
At your instigation?
Well, myself and Mildred Joanne Smith, all the women of us, because, and the people from in Hollywood too, because there were some of them there who felt that it was an opportunity to open up the union to more people. So it was a combination of attitudes and feelings and, happening to know what's going on. I said, hey, we can fix this.
Joseph Mankiewicz directing. How is he as a director? What
was
Beth's life?
Joseph Mankiewicz was one thing about him. any negative thing that I may have experienced, that any of us may have experienced, but we were having such a good time, and we were working. We had a job, so it really things were different from that perspective, but we still noticed things. But Joe was so welcoming, and Joe treated us as if he was just waiting for us to come and join the Hollywood scene. You know, he was a marvelous director. He reminded me, in a way, of Marty Ritt. I don't know if you know that director. He did Edge of the City.
Edge of the City.
Under him, with him.
Well, let's talk about that. And you were with Sidney Poitier.
Sidney Poitier and Johnny Cassavetes. Oh my, what a team! I'd known Sidney for a long time because he was part of the American Negro Theater, and his wife and I were very good friends. No, he wasn't married then, but he was like one of the younger guys coming along, and. Cassavetes, he was an extraordinary young man. And I learned a lot from him that stayed with me for a very long time. There was a uniqueness about him. He was the one that I first remember making a film and having it cost as little as possible. He used his own garage and his own clothes and furniture, and I think he maybe used his own bed, you know, in his own bedroom, and doing things like the husbands and friends and ad-libbing the dialogue. And he was inspiring. He was one of the first people who made me begin to appreciate the possibilities when you're bold enough and imaginative enough.
You worked with him on Virgin Island as well.
On Virgin Island.
Tell us about that, making of that film. Any scenes or incidents pop out for you?
Do what?
Any scenes or special scenes or incidents pop out during the making of that film?
The scenes, yes, were just delightful. It was a romance with Johnny and this young English girl, and Sidney and I were supposed to be romantically linked. And one time I was supposed to leap into the boat, and Sidney didn't want me to do that because he was nervous that I might fall. He didn't know, I really could do that, you know. and another time, the English girl, I forget her name now, but she was a stunning, she was a lovely girl, and we went to work on a boat, and she would ride bare-breasted from the island we stayed on to where we went to work. And I thought that was, I guess the English learned this from the Africans. Or something like that occurred to me. But I remember thinking that was being so amused by that. And she was absolutely, you know, it was an innocent, beautiful gesture.
John Cassavetes. Again, on that film, did you have many scenes with him yourself?
Yes.
And what did he teach you anything about acting?
Oh, John. Well, not in so many words, and you know, we were all about the same age, I guess. And one of the most exciting things that happened during the filming of Our Virgin Islands was the fact that Johnny Cassavetes. We used to talk about film a lot, and he was a lover of the whole business, and he gave me a 16mm Bolex. Yes, with a light meter and instruction books, and we talked to him, and he talked to me all the time about filming, and I got so excited. I was excited about the possibilities of making film. To make a long story short, I filmed everything from clouds in the sky on the airplane to a wall being built in my house to my mother and father having an argument to my children, you know, all kinds of things. And eventually that camera was stolen, and I never got back to it. And I'm so regretful because Johnny brought a whole another dimension of film to me that I feel sure that I should have pursued, because I'm now in innovative ways that I'm cooking it now to do in other in other ways, as a writer.
Well, I think you'll go back to it. I'm sure you will.
Oh, I pray
so. I wanted to bring up one film real quick. A Raisin in the Sun. But first you did the stage. You played Ruth Younger on stage.
Yes.
Tell us about that play and Lorraine Hansberry and your participation in the play and the movie.
Well, to tell you the truth, when Lloyd Richards, the director, asked me to read the play, he had given it to me a week before, and I hadn't read it the whole week, so one Saturday morning, I read it very fast because he was going to call me that afternoon, and he did. And I was so moved, I thought, and this author was only 20-something years old, in her early 20s, Lorraine Hansberry. I hadn't met her yet, and we were going to have a meeting at Phil Rose's house. I think it was that weekend. So when Lloyd called me, I was ecstatic. I said, this is a stunning part. I'd love to do it. And she's so exciting. And I love the scene when those scenes when she's talking with Asagai. And he said, Ruby, that's not the character I want you to do. I want you to do Ruth. And just something just dropped out of the bottom of me.
Because
I wanted to do Beneath her, because I'd done Ruth a sort of number of times. I'd been Sidney's wife. I think I was named three or four times Ruth as his wife. And so he said, "Oh, Ruby, I'm so sorry." He said, "But I need you to do Ruth." He says, "It's this," and as I thought about it, and anybody says he needed me, well, you know. Okay, and I understood once I did the part, she backgrounded much of the story. She was like maybe Lorraine's mother, and Lorraine was such, I'd never met this kind of brilliance in a young woman before. She was like a personality I'd never known before. I didn't know, not even in the American Negro Theater, although I'd known some very gifted people. But Lorraine was different in a very special way.
So she helped you with the part in the film as well. She was a
yeah. She helped me to understand Ruth too, and also the very fact that she was writing about circumstances and people that were not usually depicted in film. You know, she was a groundbreaker. She brought us to other levels and dimensions. Black and white people in America, and it was a solid hit, and it's still playing someplace. Every year, somebody's doing A Raisin in the Sun. I only wish she was still here to be writing.
Talk about the mother character, the actress who played the mother.
That was Claudia McNeil. Claudia McNeil. Oh, what an extraordinary actor she was. She had a voice like brown black velvet, you know. She could sing like nobody I'd ever heard sing before. We had challenging moments as actors working together, but when she walked on stage, she filled it completely. You understand what I'm saying? But I enjoyed working with her, Claudia, but I used to dream though about, ooh, you know, one of these days I'm gonna.
Sidney Poitier, this was a big film for him as well. Did you all feel like this was such an important, more than usual, this is a big important film?
Oh yes, it was an important film for Sidney, and because I don't think he'd done that kind of exploration. And Lorraine had given us all a challenge. These characters, most of them we hadn't seen on stage before, maybe Mama, but even she was unique in what she wanted for her children and so forth, and Sidney, this was a very different role for him, but what was so marvelous was every night you saw Sidney working to get what it was. Lloyd Richards and Lorraine wanted, what he felt they wanted. And then he had an electricity about him and a powerful commitment that changed the dynamics of that piece.
When you transferred it to film, was it hard for you to do it from the stage, since you did it on the stage, into the film, or was it easy?
it was easier having done it on stage, because it was easier, because we'd achieved a depth of understanding beyond what a screenplay itself would have called for had we not had this rehearsal in the realities, yes.
Real quick, we talk about the Jackie Robinson story. You played opposite Jackie Robinson playing himself. How strange was that?
Oh, that was extraordinary, because playing opposite, playing with Jackie Robinson, I was very excited again. I was doing the understanding good girlfriend of a very important man, and so both it was, but I was a little bit awestruck, because everybody was making such a fuss about him, and I really hadn't known that much about baseball. I'd only come to an appreciation of it since he joined the leagues. And my mother was a baseball fanatic. You know, when I think about it, I wish we would have taken Mama Emma to the ball games much more. But the one thing I remember. Jackie, in one scene I had to, you know, give him a massage, and I always had these on his shoulders, and we were in this scene, and I put my hands on his, I was always cold in those days, in this, and so my hands were cold when I placed him on his shoulder, and he glared back at me, you know, and I think the whole country, because the whole room could hear my stomach growl, you know, just from sheer nerves, and wishing, oh my God, you know, and I immediately moved them, but I have that picture though. But he was considerate and patient, and I came to appreciate him as a man as well as a ball player during that film. And I met Rachel, his wife, and I held their baby, their first baby.
And so you became friends with them?
Oh, yes. And Rachel went out to their house up in, they had another place in Connecticut. I think it was Connecticut, where they used to have jazz concerts every year in on the lawn. And oh, yes, we got to be, and we'd meet him many times on the struggle circuit, I call it, you know, working for some appearing for different causes and that kind of thing. And Jackie was very, very caring and sensitive and active.
Yeah, he was a great man, that's true, but how was he as an actor?
You know, I liked him because he understood what the director was that was
Alfred Green.
What he was doing, because he took the best of the moments, and there was a raw honesty about Jackie, and the director, we all sensed it, and worked with that quality in him, and I think that. That is what helped us all make the difference, because I thought he was thoroughly believable and charming. Yeah.